Let's move forward. First of all, tomorrow there is no lecture, and because there are degrees, it is degree day tomorrow, and I cannot teach. It was already scheduled in my calendar. If you noticed that before, I didn't include tomorrow's lecture in the calendar since the beginning, because I knew of that. So nothing is changed. I just wanted to remind you that tomorrow we will not meet, and therefore we will meet again next Monday, and the next Tuesday you will be required by me to bring the PC. I just wanted to anticipate to you 1 week earlier so you can get prepared, because as you may remember, we just started with the exercise of the computation of the fluctuation curve, and therefore I want to continue next Tuesday. We will not have exercises every Tuesday, but at the beginning, I just want to get the first exercise completed, and then we will stop for 1 week. Okay, and I remind you that we are talking about assessment of water resources availability with inductive methods, and in particular, we started with surface water. So, if we look at our list of lectures, we are at the second one. I put online the third one, which we will discuss today. And so far, we are still at the stage of inductive methods. So let me go to the lecture that we are talking about. Which is this one. Which is this one. And in particular, we got more or less here, computation of the flow duration curve. And I mentioned to you that when we deal with the estimation of individual yearly curves, we can estimate a kind of band, not just the average flow duration curve, but a band of river flows such that with the assigned probability we get for a given year the flow duration curve included in that band. I mentioned to you, this is just a reminder, that I started talking about probability, and this gave to me the opportunity to highlight the importance of statistical analysis, and in particular through probability theory in water resources management. But I told you that I am assuming that we still don't know this theory. I know that you took already some statistics and probability courses in your background, but I anticipate that I think that this is an important piece of theory that we need, and therefore in a subsequent lecture I will just dedicate some time to remind you what are the basis for probability theory, and what is the purpose of studying probability theory in water resources management and the design of water resource systems. And it will be a very technical lecture on the meaning of probability. So far, I just wanted to highlight what is the meaning, what is the utility, the usefulness of probability concepts in our context. So let's just, we will develop an exercise here in order to estimate this band. So far, let's keep this concept suspended, let's say, until we study what probability is and how probability can be used to estimate that band. From a technical point of view, it's intuitive to understand what is this band. It's, if we get a given year, this is the range where we expect the flow duration curve lying within. Okay, because there is variability from year to year, and therefore, of course, we cannot say that in a given year we expect the average curve. We will never get the average. We will get something varying within a certain range. And this is the range where it's likely that we get, for a given year, the flow duration curve within. Okay, and I mentioned to you that we can estimate, the basing on the flow duration curve, we can estimate the water volume that we can withdraw from a river. And I mentioned to you that we can estimate also the average river flow during the year that we can expect from a river. The average river flow can be computed from the flow duration curve, and the volume that we can withdraw from the river can be computed as well from the flow duration curve. Of course, once that you know the volume of water that on average you can get from a river, you can also estimate the average flow that you can withdraw from the river. Because let's indicate this volume as VP, which is again the average volume withdrawn. Where average is to be intended across the years. So once that we get this VP, which is again the volume on average that we expect to take along a year, we can also estimate QMP. What is QMP? It is the flow volume per unit time of withdrawn water that we can expect to get from the river, which is equal to VP divided by time, which is, time is the duration of 1 year. So this is the average flow. It is the flow that, if it was taken at a constant rate, would allow us to get VP. So if we were able to get a constant flow from the river, we are not able to get a constant flow, because you see, we can get a flow equal to the design flow QP for a certain time, and then the flow that we can get from the river decreases. So we can't get a constant flow. But we can define QMP, the average withdrawn flow, as the flow that it was, if it was taken constantly, uniformly, would along the year, would origin, would allow us to get the volume VP. And also we define the QM as the average flow in the river. And also we defined QP as the design withdrawn flow. Okay, now basing on these quantities, we can define two indexes, which are important to quantify the behavior of our water withdrawal, of our captation, water captation from the river. And these indexes are defined here as water withdrawal index, which is the ratio between the design flow QP and the average flow QM. This is the water withdrawal index. It is usually greater than one, not necessarily, but usually it's greater than one. So it is the design water withdrawal divided by the average flow of the river. And then there is the water use index, which means the average water withdrawal divided by the average flow of the river. Average water withdrawal flow divided by the average flow of the river. And this is always, always less than one. Because we cannot take from the river more water than what is there. So if we want to, in a way, to preserve the environment, we need to decrease the water use index. And of course also to decrease the water withdrawal index, even if what is more connected to the quality of the environment is the second one, the water use. Okay. Please do remember how these two indexes are defined. Do remember how these quantities are defined, because this could be a question at the exam. And if you have any doubt on what I just said, please ask questions. Okay, I mentioned to you that there are a couple of examples of barrages, river barrages, that I illustrated here. The first one we already discussed, it's on the Danube. The second one, I told you, take some time to read it. It's the run-of-the-river hydropower plant over the Po River at Isola Serafini. The idea here is very simple, and keep in mind that a run-of-the-river hydropower plant, I consider it a water resource system. It is not conceived for using water, but it's conceived for exploiting water resources. If we take a broad vision, it's a water resources exploitation, hydropower production, so I consider it a water resources system. And the idea is very simple. There is a meander in the Po River. So this is the flow, the direction of the flow. And there is a meander in the Po River like this. And the idea was to cut a canal here and to put a barrage here in order to create, to induce an elevation gain between the two ends of the artificial canal. And the plant is placed in over the canal. So the idea is to build these two barrages, one on the original course of the Po River, to avoid that water flows in along the original course of the Po River. And so water is also blocked by the hydropower plant over the artificial canal, so we accumulate water upstream, therefore originating a jump in the river level, because the upstream level is kept constant and the downstream level of course decreases because water flows downstream, and therefore by turbining the water through this jump, we produce electricity. And It is a very important plant, and I just want to, it is very easy to read. There are pictures explaining, and of course it's better to look at these pictures on your PC rather than on the screen, because now the visibility is not optimal. What I just wanted to comment with you is the graph of the flow duration curve and associated power duration curve. So basically what you see here is the duration of 1 year, like in the flow duration curve. In, along the ordinates, you have different quantities. Let's try to understand this graph, because I think it is meaningful. First of all, there is the river flow duration curve that you see here. It is the red line here. I put the mouse there. So there is the flow duration curve, the original one, which is a thin line up to the level of up to the level where it becomes thick, and we will see why it becomes thick. We have the design flow of the hydropower plant, which is indicated as 1,000 cubic meters per second, and basically it is indicated with a thick line, and the thick line in general indicates the discharge that is turbined. So you have a constant discharge that is turbined, and it's equal to the design flow of the turbine up to the duration of, on the river flow duration curve, of 1,000 cubic meters per second. And then once the flow duration curve of the river is crossed, we can turbine only the discharge that is depicted by the flow duration curve. With the blue lines, you see the downstream and upstream, water levels. The upstream water level is assumed to be constant, and of course, it is under regulation, so indeed we can make an effort to keep it constant. The downstream water level is related to the original flow duration curve of the river. So it decreases for decreasing river flow. The pink line is the variable head. Of course, it's increasing for increasing duration. Why is that? Because for increasing duration, we have the downstream level that is decreasing. And therefore, the variable jump, head is a synonym of jump, is increasing for increasing duration. So what is the result? The result is that we can depict a hydropower duration curve, which is the thick red line. And what we can see is that for low duration, we have an higher flow that is turbined. We have the design flow that can be turbined for low durations. But for low duration, the design flow can be turbined only for a small amount of time, for a small duration, and with a smaller head. So the hydropower that we get is for duration close to zero is small, and then it increases because we increase duration and we increase the head, and then we get to a point where we get the maximum hydropower and the maximum hydropower is taken at the duration of the design flow, 1,000 cubic meters per second. And then, after this stage, after this point, after this duration, we get a decrease of the power because of decreasing usable discharge. So I think this is indeed a good example of inductive estimation of water resources availability, in this case for hydropower production. Okay. Now I think we can turn to inductive assessment of groundwater availability. Always inductive. Inductive means based on data analysis. No models so far. And talking about groundwater is much more complicated than talking about surface water. And the reason is very simple. The reason is that we can't observe what we are trying to understand. With rivers, we can observe. And therefore, being it possible to observe the river flow, we estimate water resources availability by measuring the river flow. In aquifers, the situation is much more complicated. And it is much more complicated not only for the problem of observing, not only because aquifers are less observable. The main problem is also to define the extension of the aquifer, to define what we call the control volume, so the volume of the space where we want to concentrate our attention, the volume of the space where the flows takes place. When we talk about groundwater, we are still talking about flowing water. It's not a static reservoir, groundwater. In some cases it can be, because the recharge is so slow that it's close to static. But in general, the groundwater we are interested in is part of a dynamic system. It's not static. And we are interested in this behavior. We are interested in groundwater that is flowing, not static, because flowing means that it's recharged. And therefore, as I said, it's difficult to define the control volume, so the volume where this flow of water takes place. In a river, it's very easy. You see the river, you understand, you can see the body of water flowing, and your control volume is given by the river. With groundwater, you can't see the flow, and you don't know whether it's a small body of water, it's a large body of water. You don't know if it is transboundary, if it is an international body of water, rather than a very local body of water. When we dig a well and we start taking water, in principle, we don't know whether the reservoir, the groundwater reservoir, is large, small. Of course, we have means to try to understand what's going on in the underground, but it is much more complicated. This is the reason. So it's difficult to observe and it's difficult to understand the extension of the water body, which in mathematical terms is the control volume. We will define with more rigor the control volume later on. It's important to start understanding that we need to define a volume in the space where we focus our attention, where we try to understand. And this is called the control volume. And in our case, it's the water body. So how does an aquifer work? I'm sure that you had already some background about aquifers, but I want to give a fresh overview of what groundwater is and what an aquifer is. So first of all, let's define what is an aquifer. And there is a link to a Wikipedia definition in my tutorials. And basically, an aquifer is an underground layer of water-bearing permeable rocks. So it's a layer, an underground layer of rock that is able to store water, rock or soil. And therefore it is interesting because if it's able, this layer, this underground layer, to store water, of course we can take water from it. Okay, and so let's try to understand how an aquifer works. I will be in my treatment of aquifers and groundwater, I will be qualitative, not quantitative. I will not go into very technical details because you have other subjects, other courses focusing on aquifers and groundwater. So I just would like to give you an overview and to explain from a technical point of view what are the means, the tools that you can use to assess groundwater availability. And keep in mind that this is a challenging problem. It's extremely important because much of the water for civil use everywhere is taken from groundwater. Water for irrigation is mainly taken by rivers. Water for civil use is mainly taken from groundwater, and the reason is that it's more protected, so the quality is generally higher. You understand that groundwater is protected by the ground, while a river is exposed to several pollutant factors. This is a scheme of an aquifer, a general scheme. So you can see these layers containing water in the underground, and broadly speaking, aquifers can be divided in unconfined aquifers and confined aquifers. The unconfined aquifer has as its upper limit the water table, and the water table is the level of the underground water. The level of the water table is not horizontal, as you may perceive. Like the level of a river, the level of water in a river is not horizontal, it's inclined downstream. Why is that? Because in order to flow, water needs energy. And therefore, part of the energy is due to the potential energy, to the energy that water has because it's placed at a given altitude. Therefore, the level of water is generally decreasing in the direction of the flow, especially for groundwater, because much of the energy of groundwater is potential energy. Groundwater doesn't have a relevant kinetic energy because it flows very slowly. What is the main difference between groundwater and river water in terms of hydraulic behaviors is the velocity. In rivers, water flows much faster than in groundwater. Much and much faster. Therefore, water in a river can even gain elevation by spending kinetic energy, by using the energy from the fact that it's moving fast. In groundwater, the movement is very slow, and therefore, in general, the water table is losing elevation in the direction of the flow. So this is why here you see that there is the water table is not horizontal. Water table is defined as the level of water underground by excluding the capillary head, the head given by capillarity. So you may start to find some humidity if you dig in the ground. You may start to find some humidity before reaching the water table. When you actually see water, then you reach the level of the water table. Water can, you know, can gain elevation with respect to the water table for the effect of capillarity forces, capillary forces. Okay. And as I said, the unconfined aquifer has the water table as its upper level. And the water table is the water table, the pressure at the level of the water table, it's the atmospheric pressure. And I want to be more rigorous in defining the water table. I define the water table as the level of the underground water. We must add at the atmospheric pressure, because I tell you what is the exception. For a confined aquifer, instead, you see that the water level is limited by an impermeable layer. So you have the water, the level of water that is given by this layer, which is impermeable. But the pressure at the water level is not atmospheric pressure. The aquifer, it's called confined because it is under pressure. It is at a pressure that is higher than the atmospheric pressure. It means that if you dig a hole in the impermeable layer, you have water flowing up because of the effect of pressure. So in this case, you can't say that the level of the layer is the water table because you don't have atmospheric pressure there. You can say that the water table is at the level of the unconfined aquifer above, because in that case you have the water level at the atmospheric pressure, so it's a water table. I hope it is clear. So why the confined aquifer is under pressure? Typically it is under pressure because the recharge comes from the mountains, which are at a higher level. So there is underground water flowing down from the mountains, getting here. And then there is a confined, an impermeable, a low hydraulic conductivity layer that puts water under pressure. You see that the water table can cross the topographic surface, not only in rivers like in this case, but in general you may have if you have a soil profile like this, you may have an aquifer that is sloping downstream. The water table is sloping downstream in this way and may cross the topographic surface. So let's suppose that you have an aquifer that is flowing in this way. Let's suppose that you have here recharge through rainfall, so this is rain, and then there is infiltration. This is infiltration. And then let's suppose that you have an impermeable layer here, which is sloped downstream. It is sloped, sorry, in this direction. So what happens is that through infiltration, you may have the water level that, and let's suppose that this impermeable layer is getting thicker and thicker like this. So basically what it may happen is that through infiltration, you have the water table that is accumulating over the impermeable layer, and then it gets it crosses the topographic surface, and then here you have a spring. So where the water table crosses the topographic surface, you may have a river or a spring. And in the case you have a river, which is generally always connected with the water table. It's generally always connected because the river usually flows over a permeable unit, over a permeable soil, and therefore it is the river is always connected with an aquifer unless it flows over a rocky bed. And if there is connection between the river and the aquifer, it may happen that the aquifer recharges the river, or the other way around. The aquifer may be recharged by the river. It depends on the dynamics of the aquifer. So it's important to try to understand how this system works